This conference will now be recorded.
Yeah, thank you guys. Thanks for joining the call. So today, what we are going to have is, this is an overview session about Oracle Integration Cloud, along with Fusion Technical. So we are going to do this training very focused around Fusion Technical and Integration Cloud. So before I go ahead and discuss, okay, first of all, what I'm going to cover today. Today I'm going to provide some overview about the training, like what are the course contents or what are the topics we are going to cover in this training, and how we are going to cover, how we are going to do the training, like what kind of resources will be available for you people, what kind of practices you are supposed to do during the training, etc. How I'll be able to help you guys on those practices as well. And before that, before I provide the details about the actual training, I'll be providing some background about this technology, why actually we are learning this technology, what is the purpose of this technology, a little bit of evolution, how this technology came in the industry, etc. Okay, with that, let me also introduce myself. I am Bhaskar. I have been in the IT field almost for the last 20 years. More than last 10 years, I have been working in Oracle Fusion Middleware technologies like Oracle SOA, Oracle ADF, also like Oracle Apex, closely with Oracle ERP and Oracle Fusion applications, integrations, etc. So I have experience in web technologies, integrations, ADF development, Apex development, on-premise to cloud integrations, cloud to cloud integrations, and so on. Okay, so with this, so coming to this training, Oracle Integration Cloud and the technology. So most of the people who are learning this technology or even who are on the call, I believe you have some experience in Oracle applications. So either you are the application Oracle Apps technical consultant or technical expert or Oracle applications techno-functional expert. Or some of you might be working Oracle SOA also, like the, that is like integration technology, and you would like to basically learn Oracle Integration Cloud now. If you're apps technical, you would like to learn this technology so that you will be able to work the technical side of Fusion applications. And if you are in integration already, Oracle SOA, etc. So this is a new platform available on the cloud, so that you'll be able to learn and develop your integrations using this integration cloud. Okay, so coming to Oracle applications. Right, the Oracle applications is what technologies are used in Oracle applications. The main technologies in Oracle applications is it's a more around the database technology. So the people who work in Oracle apps usually you are experts in Oracle database, right? RDBMS concepts, etc. And you are experts in SQL and PLSQL. So in Oracle apps technical, most of the things what you do in terms of if you're customizing any business logic, or you're doing any kind of integrations with Oracle apps, like inbound and outbound integrations, usually you'll be dealing with PLSQL programming, PLSQL development, right? Because it's an on-premise application, so you will be having complete access to the backend of the application, that is the Oracle database. You also have the access to the SQL, the PLSQL APIs, which are exposed in the Oracle apps. So you can access those APIs in the integrations what you're developing in case of Oracle applications. But when it comes to Fusion applications, the Fusion applications, there is a lots of change in terms of technology. Functionally, probably it's not changed too much, because the business functionality will be still more or less same what it was earlier. But the kind of technology used for developing these Fusion applications is entirely different compared to Oracle applications. The Fusion applications, it's completely a web technology oriented application. So when you say web technology or web application, so here the UI is everything will be available as a HTML, it's a web UI. And not only that, the most of the business logic also might be available in the middleware. So in case of Oracle applications, all your business logic will be lying in the PLSQL. But when it comes to web applications, the business logic may be shared between your backend and also in the middleware. So we'll be talking a little bit more about what is middleware, what exactly what kind of logic can go there, etc. in some time. So, and here another thing, the fusion applications, everything is available on the cloud, right? It's available as a SaaS. So when it comes to SaaS, so there are lots of restrictions in terms of what you can access programmatically. In the sense, in case of fusion applications, you cannot directly get access to Oracle database. You cannot directly get access to PLSQL APIs in the fusion applications, right? So in that case, there are a lot of limitations in terms of customizations, what you can customize. And also, if you want to do any kind of integrations, how you will be able to do the integrations. So there is no PLSQL APIs directly available. So most of the integrations will be happening with the help of web services here, right? So that is the major difference, the technology change happened between Oracle applications and Fusion applications. Now, coming to the Fusion applications, again, if you want to really understand about the technology, it's a very high level, you can say it's a web technology, but very specific to if you want to refer, it is a Fusion middleware, right, FMW. So FMW is what Oracle has used as a technology to develop the Fusion applications. So I'll be coming to again FMW, what are the different models available in that in some time. So before that, let me quickly give a little bit overview about web technologies, right? Since we are talking about web technology is a technology used for Fusion applications. So what is a web technology or web application, right? Because if you understand this technology, the basics of the fundamentals of the web technology, it will become easy to deal with any new situations when you are working in the Fusion applications, integrations, etc. Because so when you are learning, when you are working with Oracle applications, if you don't know the fundamentals of RDBMS, even though you might be doing some SQL, some PLSQL, but there'll be always some doubt, like, is this the best way to do, etc. But when you are thorough about the fundamentals, and then you will not have any doubt. You'll be 100% confident this is the best way to achieve the solution for a given problem. But when it comes to web technology, what is happening here is you people are already working database technologies. Now you have to use the web technologies here. Of course, you cannot go back and start learning web technology, develop web applications, because that is not what you need to do today. You may have to do some custom application development, but the main focus is you want to do some integrations, you want to work with these the services which are exposed with the Fusion applications, etc. But in spite of that, you should be having the clarity on the fundamentals. So the fundamentals are here web technologies and the web services. If you have the clarity on those two things, then you will be more confident, right? So when it comes to web technology, the web technology means the UI will be always your browser, right? So what are the user interface you're developing that can be accessed using your browser, right? So that means it is a HTML. So what happens now? Let us take any simple use case. I go to an application, web application, and I have a form. So what I want to do in that, I want to create some new record. Like I have an application for developing some, creating a customer, right? So I have a form. I enter all the customer details and then I submit for that. So what will happen? So when I submit that form, it has to go and create one new record in your database. So in any application, whether it's a web application or some other application, your database is not going away. You're still having a database, that is the backend. So this is RDBMS. So here I have a schema which is already designed. And so when I submit the form details from the browser, this details has to be submitted to your Oracle database, and then it has to create some new record in your table. This has to happen. But what happens in case of web application? There is no direct link between your UI application or the UI and your backend database. So there is always one more component coming to picture, that is your middleware, or you can say web server. There's a web server. This is also called application server, right? And this is also referred as middleware. So you would be hearing this word many places, middleware. So what is middleware? Which is nothing but it's an application server or a web server, which is acting as a runtime environment for your application, a web application. So what happens in case of web applications? So UI submits a request. The request goes to your web server, and the web server will be communicating with the database. Okay, so how it communicates then, it's again a question. Because when it comes to the pure web server, the web server doesn't know anything about your business logic. The web server and your browser will communicate using a protocol called HTTP. That is a protocol, it will be used. So every protocol has a set of rules for communication, right? So when you say HTTP protocol, so whenever a command coming from your browser, so how the web server should be treating that? The same thing, like when the response comes from web server to the client, so how it is going to treat? So that is the, there are such certain set of rules in HTTP protocol. Okay, so we, let us not, I mean, I'm not really going in depth of these things, just to get an idea. I'm just touching. I'll be finishing up this one in 5 minutes, and then we'll go to our actual future middleware and Oracle Integration Cloud. So I'll be showing a couple of demos also, like, you know, on the real integration cloud towards end of the session, and I'll be taking some questions like, you know, around that or about the course towards end of the session again. So let me take, like, you know, complete this one, the basics. So that's how it works. So now the web server doesn't know any business logic. So because of that, what we do, we have to develop that business logic here. So that business logic we call, those are called server-side components. So we develop, when you develop a web application, which you may not be doing usually because we are usually customizing and extending our existing applications. But the people who are working as a web application developers or fusion application developers in Oracle, etc. So when they say they are developing the application, they are developing some server-side components which may contain some business logic. So some business logic means the minimum business logic will be whenever the request comes. In this case, I want to create a customer. The customer details are coming from the browser to web server. Now the web server doesn't know how to create the customer in the database. So what it will know? There'll be some configuration already done as part of the application development saying, whenever the create customer request comes from this for this specific application, that request should go to so-and-so server-side component. And what is the server-side component here? Usually it will be some program, like it could be a Java program. It could be C# program in case of .NET, right? It could be even PHP also. So you're writing a program, business logic is nothing but a program. And that program knows now how to extract the data, whatever is coming from this request, and also make a connection to your database, and also execute a SQL statement on the database. So it has to take the input, then connect the database, and form the SQL statement on the fly based on the input coming, like in this case, insert statement. Then execute the statement on the database. That whole thing will be taken care of by your server-side component. So in case of Java, so this connectivity called JDBC, Java Database Connectivity, right? In case of like no C# and PHP, the protocol could be different, but ultimately it has to connect the database and execute the SQL statements. Okay. So in this layer, there are different technologies available in the market. When it comes to UI development, it is all about HTML, JavaScript, and CSS. Then we also have, like nowadays, jQuery. Then you have AngularJS, right? Etc., etc., in case of UI development. When it comes to web server or middleware server-side components, so we have Java. We also call Java Enterprise Edition. We have Hibernate. Then we'll be having some Spring Boot, etc. Right? In case of C#, we have the .NET. It's a framework. So all these technologies are helping us to develop your server-side components. Right? So here, so when it comes to database again, database is not changing much, even though there are some NoSQL database, in-memory database, etc. But still, the majority of the applications you are using still RDBMS. And when it comes to RDBMS, you need to know the RDBMS concepts and also SQL and PLSQL. So this is not going away. Now, even in case of web applications, the application logic may be still available in PLSQL, but the PLSQL has to be called by a server-side component. So that is possible. So you'll be having a some logic may be in PLSQL and some logic may be inside your Java programs or your server-side components also. So that's how any web application works. The same way, like when I say create customer, the data comes here, then it is going to execute insert statement on the database. If you are going to search for anything, if you want to retrieve some data, that is your UI. Then what happened? The request goes here, and this is going to execute a select statement based on the where clause. It is going to form the where clause by giving the appropriate input, which is coming in the input here, and then execute the select statement, get the data. So once you get the data, it also has to convert the data into HTML, and that HTML will be available or rendered in the browser. That's how any web application works. There are only two kind of requests. Either you are creating something or updating something, then the data flows from here to here, or you're going to query something. So when you're querying, the data comes from here and converted to HTML and rendered in the browser. That's how any web application works. Okay, why we are talking about all these web applications, development, etc. Even though you are not going to develop the web application tomorrow, but you should be knowing the fundamentals, the basic, basically what is happening behind the scene when you are working with fusion applications. Not only that, if in order to understand what is web service, these basics are very, very important. Okay. If you have any quick questions, I can take now about this concept. Okay, but I'm going to build on top of what we discussed, and I'll be taking forward. So you have to unmute and talk if you want to talk. All right, so let me go ahead. And when it comes to fusion middleware, that is a technology or the technology stack we are using are used for developing fusion applications. So what it contains? It contains mainly four things. Primarily, okay, it has many things, but primarily it contains a WebLogic server, right? And then what it contains, it will be having ADF. It also has Oracle SOA and OBIE and Oracle Identity Management. So there are four major modules, and all these technologies will be running on WebLogic server. What is WebLogic server? This is an application server. So some of the examples of application servers are WebLogic. We have the WebSphere. WebLogic is from Oracle. WebSphere is from IBM. We also have JBoss, which is open source. And Glassfish also another open source. Like that, there are some application servers. When it comes to Apache and Apache Tomcat, they are very basic web servers. It is not application server. Application server means it will be having more features on top of web server, your infrastructure related, some resource management, your transaction management, connection management, all those things will be available on top of web server functionality. So when it comes to fusion middleware, so WebLogic server will be acting as your server, which is going to provide the runtime environment. And there is an ADF. What is ADF? ADF is used for developing end-to-end application, end-to-end web application. What is ADF is going to provide? Whatever you talked here, like your JavaScript, CSS, jQuery, Angular, then we have the Java Enterprise Edition, Hibernate, Spring, all these things, right? All these technologies are available as a single package, that is ADF in case of fusion middleware. So if you are using ADF, you need not learn about all these things separately. You can just learn ADF. Then with the help of ADF, you'll be able to develop your UI, you'll be develop your server-side components, and that takes care of how to communicate with the database, everything. It is very, very great technology, which is used by Oracle to develop the complete fusion application. So you see any UI in the fusion applications that is developed in ADF. There are some changes taking place. So now, recently, Oracle also introduced another alternate for this, that is a VBCS, that is called Visual Builder Cloud Service. It's also, there is something called Jet from Oracle. So it's a Jet flavor VBCS. So also meant for the similar purpose to develop the UI, basically. It's not like ADF. ADF is actually going to help to develop your backend business components, etc. But when it comes to VBCS, it's mainly focused around UI development. Your backend has to be exposed as a REST API. That is the main purpose of VBCS, the concept used over there. Okay, so to develop any large enterprise application, ADF can be a primary choice. That's what Oracle has done for developing Fusion applications. Now, what is Oracle Sova? This is used for integrations using web services mainly, right? So what is integration? So when you're having a set of applications, so there might be a requirement for exchanging the data between like your different applications, or you might want to integrate or exchange the data among some other additional, like other applications which are like a part of enterprise, which is very common, right? So in those cases, there can be very generic way of integrations developed using Oracle Sova. That is also part of available as a Fusion middleware, which will be running again on WebLogic server only. WebLogic server is your core server, which is like acting as a runtime environment. Again, we have a different flavor available now. What is that? Oracle Integration Cloud. That's what we are learning in this training. So Oracle Integration Cloud is actually becoming kind of like alternate for Oracle Sova. And this is available completely on the cloud. Oracle Integration Cloud is completely available only on the cloud. When it comes to Oracle Sova, it is available as on-premise. It is also available as a cloud service. Okay, but when you say cloud service here, the same thing, whatever you're running WebLogic server on-premise will be available on the cloud in case of Sova cloud service. But you're not changing the architecture or the interface, how we use it in case of on-premise and Sova cloud service. Okay, so when it comes to Oracle Integration Cloud, in fact Oracle has done a really great job over there by providing very complex functionality in a simple manner. So as a technology developer or technical consultant, if you want to achieve any integrations, if you want to use any web services for developing your achieving your solutions, it is very, very it will take much less effort compared to Oracle Sova in terms of the tools what you are using, in terms of maintenance overhead, in terms of terminology understanding, etc. There is a great enhancement and development when you compare between Oracle Sova Integration Cloud. So in case of Oracle Sova, you have to deal with JDeveloper, you have to understand WebLogic server concepts, you have to deal with WebLogic console and enterprise manager, all that stuff, there's a lot of overhead. You have to go to WebLogic server and create adapters, config adapters, etc. Right? JDBC data source, everything you have to take care in case of Oracle Sova. But when it comes to integration cloud, you don't do any of those things. The infrastructure is taken care by completely Oracle. It's available on the cloud. You don't need to have any additional tools for developing your applications like JDeveloper, etc. You simply go to Integration Cloud, and then you will be able to do the, when you say Integration Cloud, you are going to browser, you log into the instance, you can develop everything over there, and then you are going to activate, then it becomes service available running in the Integration Cloud. So it's really very beautiful technology. And as I said, it's a complex feature functionality of integrations available in a simple manner. Okay, the concepts are very similar to Oracle Sova. If you know Oracle Sova, learning integration cloud becomes easier. But I'm not expecting anything like that. I'm assuming that in this training, the people who are going to attend this training do not know anything about web technology. When I say do not know anything, they never work probably in the web technologies. If you know it, it's well and good. But I'm assuming that you wouldn't have worked in the web technologies, or you wouldn't have worked with any web services, and you don't know about Oracle Sova. So making those assumptions, we have designed this training. Okay, so when it comes to OBIE, this is used for reporting. So you take any application, the development is one part, and once the application is running, your business will be demanding different kind of reports from time to time. Different levels, different like you know, people in your business organization will be requiring different kind of reports. And how are you going to get those reports? On-demand reports. You cannot go and like you know, create SQL statements every time you need a report, right? That is not possible. So that is the reason you need to have some technology, some layer, which is exposing like you know, some kind of model to you. And on top of that, you should be able to easily develop the reports, having some function knowledge and understanding like you know, that that interface should be sufficient. You should not be like you know, writing SQL every time you need to create a report. So the OBI is a very generic technology which is available in the market as part of Fusion Middleware, which is like you know, going to help providing that model that is nothing but like you know, called RPD and subject areas which are like you know, exposed as part of OBI. And then there's another layer called reports and analytics. So using that, the functional experts, even the when you say functional techno-functional experts, will be able to create the reports with less effort. Okay, that is another OBIE. And when it comes to identity management, this is used for access control. So you might be needing to manage different kind of roles and responsibilities, all those things. So those things can be managed with the help of OIM. Right. Now, when I say Oracle Fusion Middleware, this technology is not just meant for Fusion applications. All these technologies can be are available as a generic technology in the market, in the industry, and each of them can be used independently. I can just use ADF, I can use only Oracle Sova, and like no other modules also. So these are generic technologies used for developing your generic applications. When I say generic applications, like in case of Sova, the integrations, in case of ADF, your like no enterprise web applications, here reporting and the access control. Right, so Oracle Sova is in fact very popular in the industry for different kind of integrations. Even though the people are not using Oracle Fusion applications, they might be already using Oracle Sova for different kind of integrations. Okay, but Oracle has developed Fusion Middleware, and they also use the Fusion Middleware as a technology stack for developing Fusion application. That is the reason we are just talking about Fusion Middleware here, right? Yes, any quick questions on that? What is FMW? I hope that is clear. At least the overview, right? So it's actually providing everything what you need to develop any large enterprise application. You need to have something to develop the application, UI, backend, all that. You need to have something for the integrations. You need to have something for reporting. And then you need to manage the security and access control, right? Everything is available as part of FMW. That is very comprehensive. Technology stack. Okay, so now, so we understood a little bit about.
Sorry, Bhaskar, one question.
Yes.
Bhaskar, yeah. So OIC is also using WebLogic server as a.
Yeah, behind the scene, it will be using WebLogic server, but you will never need to directly work with the WebLogic server.
Okay.
As a developer, as a consultant.
Because no need for creating JNDA and other things, right?
No, that will be taken care by your infrastructure automatically.
Okay.
Yeah. Right. Any other questions? So we understood a little bit about web technology and then what is Fusion Middleware. And now I'm going to talk a little bit about web services, and then we'll be moving to Oracle Integration Cloud. So let us talk about what is integration now, right? What is integration? One thing you have to just make sure that don't think integration cloud is completely different or new. Now, when I say new, you guys have been doing integrations already, right? Only thing is you guys have been doing using PLSQL. Now you are going to the similar kind of integration using integration cloud as a platform, and your web service will be a basic building block. But what you want to achieve will be similar. Here also you want to read something from the Fusion applications, or you want to send something to Fusion applications. Before sending, you may want to do some validations. You may want to like know, do some more business logic on top of that, right? Something, the requirement is same. And your approach also will be same. So when you did Fusion Oracle applications, what you did, you will be calling PRESTful APIs. Here also you're going to call some API. Only thing is the API will be web service in case of integrations. That's the only difference. When it's a web service, again, what is web service? So we'll just talk about that quickly. So now, first of all, what is integration? Integration is nothing but you're having two different applications, correct? And application one, application two, it's having its own database. And this is also having your database. And there is a requirement, like there is some API, some functionality of application two should be accessible by application one. That is a primary requirement. Now, when you need this one, this requirement is there like today also, not only in the Fusion applications, right? You have been doing this. Now, what are the different options available? If I have some functionality in the data in the application two, and I would like to invoke that in the application one, how can I do that? So one option is you can use DB link if both are using like your Oracle application, Oracle database, right? So we did that. I can get DB link from DB1 to DB2 and I can access something. But what is the limitation if I'm using DB link? First of all, both the databases have to be Oracle databases. That's the first one. What else? The limitation. The limitation can be the business logic might be lying here now because it's a web application. The business logic is not like now here. Now, if I want to use the logic which is available here as a functionality, so the DB2, in addition to application to database, what else is there? You're also having a middleware here, right? So middleware might be having some business logic. Now, this business logic and here also there might be having some middleware. So now this application wants to communicate with some functionality which is available here, then you cannot go to database channel. So you need to have some other way to access that. So what is that? Anybody would like to answer that? So if something is available here, middleware, and you would like to invoke that one from other application, how can you do that? So you have to go for web service. If it is available in the database, probably you can also go for some database user, right? So even if it is not database link, you can expose the DB2 functionality to application one. Application one wants to communicate with application two. You can create a database user, and the application one can probably communicate with the database also. But when you are talking something which is available here, you only the one option is a web service. Now, how the web service is going to help us or what it is? What is web service? You need to know that, right? If you want to use web service, you need to know what is web service. So web service is again using the same web technology concept. Okay. So what happens in web technology? The web technology, the problem here is the application one, application two might be using different technologies. First of all, this might be Java. This might be like something else, C++. Okay, that is the first thing, is that there is a technology like no difference. Not only that one, they both are not part of the same application. That means they are like remotely they have to access something, right? So all these are like coming as a complexity. Now we are saying the web service can be a solution for that. And how the web service is going to solve that issue? Basically, what is happening in the web service? You can see the web server here. So what happened in the web server? When you go to any web application, right? So what is happening? I'm typing something here. For example, I'm typing Amazon or whatever. I'm able to already communicate with the server which is available very far from my laptop. I'm in my laptop. I'm able to get some functionality which is available in this server. That means my application, which is my browser, is able to communicate with the another application which is running on the Amazon, data center. So Amazon is running one application, Amazon, that is a WebLogic server, some web server is running over there. Now this is an application which is able to communicate with that one. How is it happening? That is happening because of HTTP protocol, nothing else. So there is a client and there is a server. the client and server can communicate using HTTP protocol, right? So HTTP protocol is making everything achievable. It means the solution for web service is already available. Even the web service, like no terminology came into picture. So there is already a solution for that. When you're having two different applications which are running remotely, which are available remotely, and they may be using different technologies. So when you are using the browser, we don't know what is the browser, like the technology used for developing the browser. The browser itself is an application, is able to communicate with another application which is running somewhere else. There is also another application. I'm not talking about the functionality of this one. Even the server itself is an application there, right? So that is possible because it's an HTTP protocol. Now, what is happening in the web service? We are leveraging the same concept. And then we are saying that's a web service. Only the major difference in case of web service and the web technology. In case of web service, your client will be always another program. In case of web application, your client is the browser. That means you are not developing a client program. The browser knows how to communicate with this web application. And that is through some URL. Basically, web service or web applications will be always working with the help of URLs. So now, what I'm trying to tell is web service is not completely new technology. It is just leveraging the concept of web application, the web technology. Okay, so the web service will be available as a URL. The moment it becomes URL, it becomes technology. And location independent, right? That's the reason when I go to my browser, just by typing the URL, I'm able to communicate with that functionality. The same thing we are going to do in case of web service also. So you develop some functionality here, whatever. I may be writing a Java program. I may be writing some PLSQL program. I may be doing some other programming. You have some business functionality. Now you want to expose that as a web service. What does it mean? That means you are going to expose that functionality through web server. There will be some wrapper around your business logic. The wrapper will be exposed as a URL. So what will happen now? Whenever the request comes to web server, the request will go to your server-side component, which is nothing but a web service. And the web service internally, like now, having the business logic. That could be any technology. That's how the web service works. Okay, so the web service is really is a very simple concept, and again solving a very complex requirement. Because if you don't have this concept right, it is very difficult to. In fact, there are many other technologies like CORBA, remote method invocation. Many things came into the industry, but everything just came and again vanished because everything was having their own complexity and did too much overhead when you want to do the integrations or when you want to mixing the data between two different applications, which are heterogeneous technologies and running separate applications. So that the solution from web service actually become very successful because it's very simple and nothing else to do as a client and server. So you already the web technology concept is there, and every technology will be having some way how to call the URLs. As long as your client knows how to call the URL, that is sufficient to access your web service. So I hope that is clear. So web service is nothing but you're exposing the functionality as a URL. The moment it becomes URL, it becomes a technology independent. It means your client and server can be running in two different technologies, and they can be running in different locations also. So remotely you can access the functionality. So that is nothing but your web service. Okay. So why web service? We are talking again. The web service is the building block for any kind of integrations when it comes to either Oracle Server and Oracle Integration Cloud. So there should not be any question around what is web service, how it works. So these fundamentals should be very, very clear. Okay. Any quick questions on that?
Bhaskar, Amazon.com is a web server or it's a web service?
Amazon.com,
yeah.
So Amazon.com, we don't call it web service because we are, Amazon.com is not meant to be a web service. It is meant to be a web application or a website, right? Which is always accessible by a browser. But even if I want to call this Amazon.com from some other client, it's possible because it's a URL. URL can be accessed from any client. If I develop HTTP client, I can call this URL from my HTTP client also. That's what your browser is doing internally. So what I'm trying to mention here is the web service is using this concept behind the scene. Is that clear? Did I answer your question? Sorry. I'm not able to hear. I'm sorry. Hope that is clear, right? So don't get confused too much. Don't think too much specific also. When you say web application, it will be always called by browser. You are going to browser and using that. When you say web service, behind the scene, you are still having a web server, right? But who is going to call some other program, like your PLSQL program, it could be your Java program, it could be C++ program, is acting as a client. Okay. Right.
Okay.
Now, so now let us come to Oracle Integration Cloud. So what we learn in the Integration Cloud. First of all, why do we need another platform? We know that there is a web service. If your server can expose a web service, your client will be able to call that web service, correct? But we always go with some platform like Oracle SOA or Oracle Integration and so on for achieving your integrations. Because when you are going with web services, it won't be like to you always. It always comes with lots of overhead in terms of how you want to invoke it, right? And how you want to develop web service. So for that, you have to do something, some more effort. So when you are going to these platforms, they're going to help us easily develop your web services. They're also going to help us to easily invoke your web services. So when you say invoke web service, you're not just invoking and leaving. Before invoking, you want to do some validations. After invoking, once you get the response, you want to send it to some multiple targets, or you may want to massage some data what you are getting. You want to transform the data into some other form, or you are getting your data and you want to write that into some database. There will be different things you want to do on top of just calling the web service. So right, even if you're not using your platforms like Integration Cloud or SOA, you will be able to do this. Using Java also, I can call the integration. I can do the integrations, but the amount of effort you put will be much more there. And also it becomes too difficult to manage over a period of time when you are using simple technologies, traditional technologies. But when it comes to Integration Cloud or Oracle SOA, these kind of technologies, so they are going to provide lots of features and functionals around that, so that invoking the web services or developing the web services will become very, very easy. So with that, what I will do, I will just show a couple of, let me just log into Integration Cloud. This is my, so I have an instance Integration Cloud. I just log into that. And when you come to Integration Cloud, so you have the main thing, what you're focusing in this training will be integrations. I'll be also giving some overview and some examples on the Visual Builder towards the end of the training. And I also got some requests talk a little bit about the process cloud service. I'll also try to include something in the training about that. Okay. But the main focus will be about the integrations. This is the Integration Cloud service. Also, it's called ICS earlier. So here, integrations, again, you can create connections. You have to understand about adapters. There is something called lookups, packages, agents, and everything. We are going to cover everything about all these things in the training. What you will be doing in the integrations? You are going to create connections first. Okay, you are going to create connections with the help of adapters. What are the adapters? To access any application which is not part of your Integration Cloud, which is not part of your own integration. I want to communicate with the file system. I want to communicate with the database. I want to communicate with some other application which is not a web service. In those cases, we'll be having adapters. So in the integrations, primarily everything has to be web service. Okay, in the integration, everything has to be web service which is external to your integration. Now, but that is not possible, right? The reality is when I want to communicate with the file system is not a web service. I want to communicate with the database. Database is not a web service. So that is the reason what Oracle has done or these integration platforms have done. They have developed some adapters on top of the underlying technology. The technology will be exposed as an adapter. It means for integrations that will be looking like a web service only. But other side, it knows how to communicate with the underlying technology. So taking that concept forward, what we're having is we're having adapters for even many applications. Like I want to communicate the Salesforce. I want to exchange the data between SAP and Oracle applications. So you'll be having adapters for different targets. Okay, so if you go to adapters here, you'll be having, you can see there are 68 adapters by different Oracle Integration Cloud. So you can see Ariba adapter, AQ adapter, like that you're having application adapters and also technology adapters. Okay, so when I say application adapters, they are like your Salesforce or your SAP or your Oracle Fusion applications adapters, etc. When it comes to technology adapters, they are like your SOAP adapter, REST adapter, or file adapter, FTP adapter, etc. Okay, so the different adapters are available. You are going to create connections using those adapters. After you create the connections, you are going to create the integrations. So that is what is the finally you are going to build an integration. Now the integrations also are different kind of integrations. There is something called basic routing integration, app driven orchestration, schedule orchestration, publishing and subscribing and file transfer. There are different purpose. When you are doing very simple integrations where I want to read some data and send it to some external service, then you want to do the transformation in between, then you will be going for the basic routing. When it comes to more business logic you want to write in the application, then you are going to go for the orchestration. This is very similar to Babel in case of Oracle SOA. You may be having set of services you want to call in the orchestration, not just one, right? In that case, you are going for the orchestration. So you'll be, of course, learning all these things in depth, understanding the concept and doing several examples about different integrations, etc. Just to get an idea, what I'll be showing an existing integration here. For example, you can see here there is a supplier from DB. So this integration is already developed and available here. I was it's part of some training, it's some demo, etc. So what we're trying to achieve here is I have a Fusion application web service. So there is a Fusion application which is available on the cloud. Is having a web service for creating supplier. There is a web service. Okay, what I want to do, I have an on-premise application. On-premise application is there. On-premise application is running in my local system. Of course, it's having a database. So this database, I have a table and it has some data called suppliers. The suppliers are getting created in my on-premise database through my on-premise application interface. So my requirement is, what are the data coming into my supplier database table should be pushed into Fusion applications. It means you want to create the suppliers in the Fusion applications based on the data available in the on-premise database. I want to achieve that using the Oracle Integration Cloud. If you want to do that one, so I'll be just showing that. I'm not going to develop the integration now because that is, we are talking about some advanced integration. We should be learning as part of our training. But I'll be opening the existing integration. Let me just open that. So what we are doing in this case, you can see this is the orchestration. So what is orchestration here? You can see there are different stages here. First stage is you are reading the data from your on-premise database, on-premise application. After you read, you are getting multiple records. you want to use a for loop to traverse that complete collection. Then I want to invoke my Fusion supplier service by sending one record as an input. So when I'm calling, I need to provide the input to that one. So I will take in the current record, let know, from the collection, and map the data into, let know, the input to my Fusion application service. The one the supplier got created in the Fusion applications. So what I want to do, I want to again update my database table saying this record is already completed, already created in the Fusion applications. So for that, I would like to do some mapping here, etc. So basically, I have a database also here. You can see the local database. I have a supplier table, which is having some set of records. It's having supplier name, supplier number, like some tax organization type, some fields are there. I'm also maintaining some field here. So by default, it is having P. P means like the data is prepared here. It's the table already available. Now S means this is already processed by the integration cloud. Okay. So, but I also want to make sure that like whatever I want to create, I need to like to change the status to end. I'm just putting some logic like to watch in my requirement. So ultimately what I want, if I go to Fusion applications, this is my Fusion application UI. Okay. The Fusion application UI, I think others are joining. Okay, Sachin, I need some more time, please, if you joined. Okay, so here, so these are Fusion applications. I come to, let me go to my UI, the main. So I have, procurement here. In the procurement, I go to suppliers. Okay. So in the supplier, I'm seeing like there's a list of suppliers already created here. Now what I want to do, what are the data available in my database here in my local system? Okay. Some of the records I want to get created. So I'm maintaining like whichever status having N, let me change that to N, like a couple of fields. For example, these four. I want to make it N. Okay. So now you can see here BK demo, like to something like there are four fields. All these four records I made it N. So what my integration cloud will be doing is my integration cloud, the integration, whatever developed here, is having a logic. Read only the records which are having the status N. And then only create those things in the Fusion application. That is the logic I'm using here. So that is the reason to demo that I'm making some records as N. So if you go and check this one now, BK demo, right? You search for that in the Fusion applications. So Fusion applications, search field here. Manage suppliers. So let me search for BK demo. So I don't have any. So I don't have any records here, correct? So what I want to now, I'll go to my integration. I'll just submit one request here. Let me first see if this is, yeah, this is update, right? So I go to integration. I will submit one request to this integration. I can say submit now. This is a scheduled integration. So I'm saying submit now. So I can also go and do the monitoring here. What happened to my request is this. So if I just refresh here, you can see one message received, still not completed. You can refresh this. So one success now. Now you can go to Fusion application UI and search for BK demo and see. See, all four records got created here with the data what is reading from a local database, which is the on-premise application. So this is a very simple use case for on-premise to cloud integration. You are creating the Fusion application data in the Fusion applications by just like with the help of this integration. In this example, what I have shown, I have to submit the request, but I can also schedule this. I can also schedule like run every 1 hour. So every 1 hour it will go and pick up all the records which are having status N, and then create the records into Fusion applications, right? Not only that, if you go back and check here, like these four fields, now you can refresh this one. Just open that. The data, those four fields, that status should be Y. You can see that. It's also updating saying status Y, so that when it is going to run next time, it will not read this data. So this is one, you can say, one advanced integration, like, you know, how you are going to learn, like, you know, of course, in detail how you can create these kind of integrations. Okay. In the similar manner, I want just one more. I'll just take the questions after that. For example, I have one integration here about FTP I want to show. Okay, so I have an integration which is going to read the data from an FTP folder, which is having a CSV file, says zip. I have a zip file in my FTP folder, and that zip file has the CSV files. I want to extract each file from the, first I want to download the zip file to my integration cloud, extract each file, CSV file. Then I want to convert each CSV file to XML file, then create another zip of that, like, my XML files, and then generate one, I mean, write that zip file into another FTP folder. So how to do that one, if you want to do that kind of thing? See, it's having more steps here. There's something called stage file. So you are going to first read the zip file. Then you are going to loop through all the CSV files. Then you are going to read that CSV structure. Then writing, like, you know, the XML stage. So this is a stage file operation. Then after you write the XML, you are going to create a zip of that one. Then you want to write the zip file to your FTP folder. So there are multiple. So whenever you're having, like, you know, set of activities you want to do in a specific order with some business logic, what you are doing is nothing but orchestration here. That is called orchestration based integrations. If you want to do this one, just, like, you can see I have a Windows API here. So what I am doing here, if you want to quickly see also, I am reading the file from so and so folder. You can see there is a FTP BK in file, that is my folder. I want to read the file from that folder. That is the file name is order csv.zip. Then what I want to do at the end, I want to write another zip file, which is going to be XML zip, and into FTP BK March 20 FTP out. That is my write folder. So I have a FTP server here, which is running. So my input is coming from this folder, that is order csv.zip. So what is then the order csv.zip? If you want to quickly see that. One second, give me a moment. Yeah, it's taking a little bit time. I think we've overrun the time, but I think that's fine. Like, I planned about 1.5 hours, so I should be completing within the next 5 to 10 minutes. Okay. So I have a order CSV. Sorry. This is my zip file. Just open this and see what is there. We're having some CSV files. So what is the CSV file again? It may be having some one record. You're having, like, some customer, some order details. Like, there are, like, three CSV files. It may be multiple CSV files basically in that zip. What I want to do, I want to read each CSV file, convert into XML file, create another zip, and write that into my FTP. That's what I want to do. So where I'm going to write it in my FTP, I have configured to write here. I don't have that zip file here, right? But my in folder, I'm having the zip file, which is CSV. So now let us try to execute and see if this is going to work. So FTP in file, I'll go to my integration, which I developed already. I will activate, this is not activated right now. So you can see this is not activated. I'm going to activate it. And then after that, right, so now I'll submit one request. Usually I'll be using submit now because like no, we don't want to automate and schedule, otherwise it's going to like no keep on doing. But in the real time, you may be writing lots of schedule orchestrations, not the just like no one times request. Okay, this also you can go and monitor. One message received for this integration, still not complete. Completed. Now you go to zip folder, I mean your FTP folder. So we were writing into FTP out. You refresh this. So hopefully you have another zip file. You can see that. Now you get this zip file. It's an XML zip. If you see there, it was csv.zip. Why I'm copying it, because I can't show otherwise. So I'm copying to my local system manually. So I copy to dtemp folder, right? And here you can see this is the file what got created. If you open this one, you have the XML file. And what is the XML file? Okay, this you should be better. Let me extract this, all of them. Get modified. So these are the, okay, those are the type. Let's say XML. These three are the files. Now you open this one. So this is a corresponding XML. The CSV file was having like 300 comma, 400 comma, like that. So we converted that into XML. Like each file will be having its own record. I'm just trying to show, like you can do all these things like in a very simple manner. Of course, if you know the technology, so you can achieve these kind of, these are very common requirements in the integrations. When you go to your Fusion application inbound and outbound integrations, you may have to deal with your like no file system, FTP database, and then like no, you're having different Fusion application web services and adapters. So all those things you are going to use and develop integrations for different use cases. So you will be in a position to provide solutions for any kind of those problems like by end of the training. Okay. Okay, so I just want to show a couple of things like that. And let me also show the integration. If you're not gone through this, this is the page having all the details about what you are covering in the training, right? The training is organized to three parts, part one and part two and part three. So many of you might be already knowing some of the part two if you're working the Fusion technical already. In the part one, we are starting with very basics of understanding about WSDL, XSD, XML, REST, etc. Then we are going to do basic integrations to very advanced integrations like what I have shown. We are going to learn this with the help of some like use cases, some project work, etc. After that, we are going to learn Fusion technical understanding about reporting, FBDI, etc., enterprise schedule service, file import export, all that like technical things. In the part three, with the help of whatever you learn in the part one, part two, we are going to put together and do some live integrations. Live integration can be like, you want to automate the FBDI. What is FBDI? File-based data import. FBDI is like, you're having some specific steps. You have to create the the CSV file using some template, upload the files to your Fusion application UCM. Then you're going to schedule the job. You can do manually. But what you want to do in the integrations, you want to automate that. Take a use case like where you have some zip file, CSV file available in some FTP folder. And you want to develop an integration which can read that file from in some specific interval and automatically upload the files into Fusion applications, process them so that the FBDI will be completed. Or it could be something like what I've shown. You're having some web service on the Fusion applications, you're having some on-premise database, you want to read the data and push to your Fusion applications. And we are going to develop different use cases around these things. using adapters, using like XML as a source, using CSV as a source. It could be one record, multiple records. Database could be a source, right? So with this, you are going to see n number of use cases with the n number of approaches, so that you will be in a position to develop any kind of integration what you need by end of the training, right? In addition to that, I'll be talking about overview of ADF, overview of Oracle SOVA, and also VBCS. I will be including something about VBCS also. There was a request about that. Oracle SOVA is very, very interesting to know after you know Oracle Integration Cloud, because concepts are very similar. And not only that, that might be very important for you guys, because when you go back to your work, if you want to work in the Integration Cloud, there might be some situations where your team is already using SOVA as a solution. You might want to communicate and work with those people also. So you should be having some overview or idea about what is Oracle SOVA, how that is different from Integration Cloud, so that you can stand and talk when you want to take some decisions. So I'll be providing enough information for those things also by towards end of the training. And the resources, you are going to get lots of resources. One thing is the instance access for Fusion applications, and the Integration Cloud instance access, FTP server access you'll be getting. And you are going to get all these resources which are having some activity guide. Activity guide is having the set of activities which you have to work on as part of practices. It's having very detailed steps. In addition to that, it may be using some reference to recordings. And these recordings are additional recordings which you'll be getting as part of your activity resource. These are called recordings activities. So these recordings are going to help you to work on practices much easier way to know the steps. So you are going to get the session recordings anyway. On top of that, you're going to get these recordings also, which will be useful for your practices. What else? Usually we are doing alternate days training, because you have to work on many practices. So your practice is very, very critical to learn the technology. So you are having no time one day between session to session, and you can work on those practices. Okay, I think I have covered most of the things what I wanted to tell. I'm sorry I didn't give chance to ask the questions, but now I'm open to take the questions. It could be any questions about training, or any, if you have any questions about what I have demoed, we can discuss that now. I hope I have given the clarity about
the resources which you are going to share with us. So those are Windows specific or Mac specific? There is nothing like that, right?
There is nothing like that. Everything is XML, okay. CSV, and WSGL files what you need. So you can use the same files for either your any platform, not a problem.
Okay.
Yeah. And by the way, when you are doing the Integration Cloud, right? Doesn't matter, because you're doing everything on the cloud anyway. Okay. Yeah.
No, you share the database, right? The database is yours is installed in your system.
Yeah, but the database
you can install. Supplier.
Yeah, that is not a problem. Database you can do anywhere.
Yeah. Okay, yeah, those resources also you will provide.
Yes, yes. Even those resources also are providing Oracle database, also SOAP UI. You need this one for testing the integrations, etc. Right? Yeah. So we are going to spend a lot of time understanding the concepts, fundamentals, web service. In fact, I didn't get a chance to talk all those things in detail. And during that time, you will be doing SOAP UI. Yeah, sorry, somebody's asking some questions.
No, I only was asking. So the about that softwares and all, that's it.
Okay. Anybody else has any questions?
Yeah, hi. So how is the scope for Oracle ICS in the future?
The future for the Oracle Integration Cloud?
Yes.
Okay, yeah, that's another point I think I missed, yeah. So when it comes to Fusion Technical, right? So in case of Oracle apps, you people used to have a SQL plus SQL as a technical work, but when it comes to Fusion Technical, in the Fusion Technical, you have One is approvals, then you have the security, then you have the reporting, right? And after that, what are the integrations? These three things are like not very technical. You may be having some bulk imports like FBDI. In case of ERP, you will be using FBDI. In case of HCM, you will be using HCM data loader, right? So all these things are a little bit technical, but functional people also can do. So what is the technical work in case of fusion applications? Is the most of the things are integrations. And now Oracle has developed the integration cloud as a primary choice for any kind of integration with the fusion applications, right? So having said that, as long as you need to do the integrations, which is of course mandatory for any implementation, so integration cloud will be there as an option. Oracle SOA was also an option, but Oracle has realized that Oracle SOA will be too difficult or too complex for the Oracle apps people to learn and become expert and use that as a solution because of the overhead of infrastructure, overhead of maintenance, and many things. Even the learning curve is very high there. So integration cloud is much easier. So the future, according to my understanding, it should be there. They may be adding more features on top of that, but the integration cloud is going to be the primary choice for any kind of integrations in terms of in the space of fusion applications. And not only that, the integration cloud is actually a generic technology, by the way. You can use this for any kind of integrations. It could be your SAP to Salesforce integration. It could be on-premise to on-premise integration also. You can use in Oracle Integration Cloud. So that is really having a lots of scope in terms of what you can achieve using Integration Cloud. I hope that answers your question.
Yeah. So in market, we had many PaaS systems. Is there ICS? So what are the competitors for ICS market?
ICS, I would say, of course, Oracle SOA itself is a competitor. And the other things are there Oracle SOA. There is also MuleSoft. And then you also have Delbumi. All these things are there. Right, but when it comes to fusion application space, usually people will be preferring integration cloud because they're already working with Oracle as a vendor, and then there'll be relevance adapters which are already available, so probably it could be primary choice. Okay,
thank you. So in future, SOA, YC is completely cover the SOA. Is there any scope?
I would not say that, because Oracle SOA will still stay there. There are some more flexibility of Oracle SOA, at least presently. Also, Oracle SOA used by many on-premise integrations, right? Which is not possible. Which you cannot force the customers to completely migrate to integration cloud, right? So that is the reason Oracle SOA will be still. Oracle is not going to take that Oracle SOA down. They will be only adding more features to SOA also. So in my opinion, if you want to become a technical expert, integration expert in the industry, you start with integration cloud because you're coming from apps background, etc., which is very relevant. At some point, you try to get the knowledge of Oracle SOA also over a period of time. That might be helpful.
So nothing but I am a SOA developer. So I need to learn apps also, right?
You need to learn what, sorry?
So I am a SOA developer. So as you said, so there is any required to learn Oracle Fusion applications also for YC?
Not really. You can be technical expert. You can only focus around technology also. You need not learn Fusion applications, because the Fusion applications is going to be your target applications. Yes, having some knowledge of those functionality might be useful, but that is not mandatory. And in our training, anyway, we are going to cover some things what is required. That will be sufficient as a technical expert, integration expert.
Okay.
Then further on top of that, it's up to your choice. If you want to make your role stronger in the Fusion applications technical team, then you may have to learn additional things also, reporting probably might be useful. But again, It depends on like, you know, where you are working, what is their requirement, etc.
But to, oh, okay. Is there any? Come back.
No, I'm telling you. Other than the integration specialist, you need not become. You need not be functional expert. Okay, you need not be knowing lots of things about fusion applications. Still, you can work.
Okay. Okay. Apps and OIC. Is there any similar topics?
You are breaking. So tell that again.
Apps and OIC has any similar topics? Is there?
In the fusion apps, you mean?
Fusion apps and OIC had any similar topics? Is there?
I'm not sure if I got your question, but the fusion applications, if you want to do the integrations, you have to go for either integration cloud or server like that.
Okay, thank you.
Bhaskar, one question. Are you going to cover the BI reporting part as well?
Yes, yeah, it is also there. In fact, we just called very fast there. So when it comes to fusion technical here, we are going to start with reporting, which is going to have the BIP reporting and also OTP reporting. But again, the primary focus is not like, you know, getting in depth of these topics. Okay, we are going to focus more around integration cloud. We are going to create a BIP report here. The main purpose of that one is when I go to the next part, I'm going to download that BIP report using integration cloud. We are going to create that integration. Okay. So that.
Yeah.
So that's the main focus. I see. Like, if you want to really become a specialist of the reporting, this training will not be sufficient. You have to learn further on top of it. But you will get definitely like, you know, some good knowledge about like, you know, how to create the reporting, OTP, BIP, and how you are going to automate like, you know, downloading these reports, integration, and all. We are going to. It's a good start. I mean. And FPD also we are going to like, you know, cover file-based data import. And again, we are going to automate that one again as part of our integrations. So you'll also learn what is enterprise scheduler, what is UCM, how to schedule the jobs, how to monitor the jobs, how to import, export like, you know, data into UCM. All those things we are going to do as part of technical. Right. Any other questions? It's long. Okay, 1.5 hours almost. I hope you guys didn't get like bored. I was talking too much about, I think initially, about the basics and understanding like, you know, the different technologies. I hope that was useful. Any questions?
No, Bhaskar.
Yeah, if you don't have any questions, we'll wind up here. Of course, you can just reach me out after the like for the session, either today or tomorrow, if you want any clarifications, either one-on-one discussion, etc. We can have that. And the training part, I'll be communicating with all of you. We'll be having Monday, Wednesday, Friday, and Saturday, 4-day sessions. The exact timing, I'll be communicating with you guys. Okay. All right. So I'll stop the recording here.
Thank you.
Thanks, Bhaskar.